First, a warm welcome to all the club's members who are present this evening. We've had really heavy interest in Professor Shiller's appearance in this networking event, and we're so glad you can be part of the evening. I'd also like to give thanks to the club's staff, particularly Activities Manager Julia Chen, for all their help in arranging the event. Our appreciation also goes out to Charlotte, Christina, Will, and the club's Activities Committee for helping all this to happen. Second, we are really pleased tonight to have students from Professor Shiller's course, Financial Markets, which is offered on Coursera, the online platform. I've personally been a very enthusiastic student of Professor Shiller's podcast in the past, and I would highly recommend that you look up this course on Coursera. I think there'll be a new course starting potentially sometime in the fall, so keep an eye open for that. And finally, very exciting tonight, this is the premier event of YaleFin. YaleFin's an alumni network for finance, banking, and market professionals across different industry segments in various localities. There are successful career groups, you know, for tech, science, engineering, journalism, Hollywood, just to name a few. But up to now, kind of crazy enough, there's never been one for finance. The Yale Alumni Association estimates that there are more than 5,000 alumni in finance in the New York area alone, and multiples of that worldwide. So it's a bit of a puzzle why no finance group exists. Maybe Professor Shiller or some of you might have a clever economic explanation for that. But in any case, we think there's huge potential value to a career network in finance. Now, certainly the Yale Club has always served this purpose. It's a valuable meeting place and nexus for the finance profession. And if you're not a member, you might think about joining. And if you're interested, we have some members of our staff in the back who could actually show you around the club this evening if you'd like. But to establish a network, a group of us set out early last year to start YaleFin. And much of that group is volunteering their help here tonight. And after Professor Shiller's remarks, one of our co-founders, Will Shikani, will tell you a little bit more about the group and offer you some ways to keep in touch with our events and to get more involved. But in a nutshell, YaleFin's purpose is to harness the incredible base of Yalies in finance, to connect you with your peers across the profession, to host interesting events like this one for your development personally and for networking, and to engage you with students in the college and also in the School of Management. And in addition to larger events of general interest, we hope to spur some smaller gatherings. In particular, industry segments, in particular, city locations outside of New York City. We would really love your ideas and help. You can follow us on our LinkedIn group, YaleFin, or feel free to email us at yalefin@gmail.com. We'd also like to thank the Alumni Association for all of their encouragement and assistance. Henry, who's here tonight, Nicholas, Waley Chang, director of the YAA, and Nancy Stratford, chair of the YAA board, who is also with us here tonight. Let's turn now to tonight's speaker. We could not think of a better inspiration for our members and alumni than Professor Shiller. Professor Shiller has made fundamental contributions to the understanding of economics and its application to economic policy, all the while, in his own words, pursuing unusual directions in this research, in his popular writing, and in his practical inventions and policy recommendations. Much of Professor Shiller's economic research has focused on patterns in asset prices. His PhD dissertation introduced novel econometric methods to test for market efficiency, applying this analysis to the bond market. His research expanded to question whether markets were efficient over a short time period, or a longer keen test for market efficiency might in fact allow for fads or fashions in investment behavior. In 1981, Professor Shiller showed that the high volatility of U.S. stock market returns actually conflicted with the prevailing conception of market efficiency, a key result that was cited in his award in 2013 of the Nobel Prize in Economics. Professor Shiller continued to study cases of widespread overvaluation by investors. He argued that ebullient market expectations can create rapid increases or bubbles in financial asset prices, which he described in two books, Market Volatility and Irrational Exuberance. Professor Shiller is well known for forecasting the bursting of the dot-com stock bubble in 2000 and the crash in the real estate market that precipitated the financial crisis. Professor Shiller's broad-ranging intellectual curiosity has often led him down more eclectic paths than other academics. In the past, his peers have warned him against going down the wrong road. These courageous explorations, however, have made Professor Shiller a pioneer in the field of behavioral economics, applying psychology and sociology to interpret economic behavior. Many of these insights are detailed in his recent popular books, The George Akerlof, Animal Spirits, and Fishing for Fools. Professor Shiller has demonstrated a tremendous knack for practical inventions of great value in the financial industry. Shiller's cyclically adjusted price-earnings ratio is the most widely referenced valuation metric for U.S. stock prices. The Case-Shiller Home Price Index is the leading measurement of U.S. residential housing prices. He's advocated derivative products to help homeowners hedge against price swings and help federal taxpayers shield themselves from unexpected declines in national GDP. He typically couples his research on market inefficiencies with detailed policy prescriptions for mitigating them. But aside from these great contributions, this crowd probably knows Professor Shiller best as a guide and a mentor. A professor at Yale since 1982, for many of us, he was the first to trace out the fascinating history of financial markets, to frame financial innovation as an evolving technology, with one productive new tool following another, like any science, and to inspire us with the potential for financial tools to improve the lives of ordinary workers and families. We know you, Professor Shiller, as a teacher, as an author, and as a contributor to our understanding of economics and policy. To do any of these so well individually is quite difficult. To be able to do all is very rare indeed. Please join me now in a warm round of applause to welcome Professor Shiller.
YaleFin for inviting me and for helping arrange this, and the people at the Puru Center for Teaching and Learning at Yale, and also the Yale Club, of which I've been a member for many years. This is, I think of as my home away from home. I live in New Haven, Connecticut, but this is my home in New York City. It's nice to be here. I was thinking about your statement that it's odd that Yale has not had an association of alumni in finance until now. But I'm thinking that maybe it has similarity to other things that I've wondered about for years. When I started teaching my financial markets course at Yale 35 years ago, there was no finance course in Yale College. Zero. I also met John Perry Miller, who was a provost at Yale at the time the School of Management was founded. And he told me, you're this is the latest twist in my financial markets course, which will be followed by a new set of lectures and for a set of and somehow stories take an important part of our thinking. We're not thinking about Euler equations. We're thinking about someone like this. And it seems to dominate everything at certain times. So the theme that I developed, I was president of the American Economic Association 2 years ago, and I gave a presidential address called Narrative Economics. And it was arguing that stories are a source of financial and economic fluctuation. That stories go viral, and they go viral for the same reason that diseases go into epidemics. There's some mutation or change in a story that makes it seem vibrant and alive, and it spreads by contagion. And so these are, to me, why do we economists not talk more about that? I documented in my presidential address that of all the social sciences in the university, finance is the least likely to talk about narratives. But it seems to me it's quite the opposite. Narratives drive financial markets. Crazy stories get started and they change everything. So I know I'm writing a whole book now called Narrative Economics, and I can't really do justice to that here, but we'll just give a little bit of an introduction. You know this story very well. I don't have to tell you this story. But I only had time to watch a little of it on TV today. I got a sense of disquiet from it. There were too many angry people. I didn't feel good to me, but somehow it's really, I actually would have watched more if I had time. Maybe you have the same feeling. So I was thinking about this story, and it reminded me of another story, which to me seems very similar. Remember this story? This is 1954. It's called the Army McCarthy hearing. That's Senator Joe McCarthy on the left in a Senate hearing. And on his right is another Mr. Cohen, who was his research assistant. And this really, it was televised for days in 1954. Anyone here watch it? Watch it. Oh, hey, that's great. Those of you who didn't watch it, you probably heard of it. So what was this all about? Well, it was Joe McCarthy who suddenly leaped into fame for his claims that the U.S. Army and other branches of government were being taken over by communists. And not only that, even worse, homosexuals. when he started the hearings, he had a high approval rating. They already had Gallup polls. His approval ratings were over 50%. Everybody was interested that the communists are infiltrating everything. But as the testimony continued, public opinion made a huge and sharp turn against him. Because they started thinking, this man is crazy. It's not like it's a mind control that communism is capturing people's souls. Now I'll come back to this, and I don't think it's possible to forecast financial markets based on one thing, but I'll show you what happened in the financial markets after these hearings. I should have maybe said this first. One of the things that's making narratives or stories more viral is the online revolution. And I just want to give my own little history of this. It's a Yale history, because I've been at Yale all this time. I first joined Yale online courses in 2003. When it was called AllLearn. It was a joint product of Oxford, Stanford, Yale, and then other universities. Diana Klein, who's a professor here of art history, is running this consider this event as sort of connected. This is another networking. It has something to do with advertising, at least, this talk on the web. But this is a sign of how the world is changing. It's getting more viral. There's more. It kind of scares me, actually, that I've reproduced myself so many times. When I get in front of my class, I wonder, what am I doing? I mean, how am I recording? I've turned myself into a robot. Anyway, I wanted to talk about finance, though, here, which is, I think, not immune to this kind of viral phenomenon. I'm going to say things rather briefly, but I wanted to show you, I hope you can see this well. This is a plot of U.S. stock prices from 1871 to the present. I actually got today at the very end. You can see these updated on my website, right? But that's way up there. The blue line, that's real inflation-corrected stock prices. It's the S&P Composite Index. The green line is a little bit hard to see, but it's real earnings per share for the same S&P Composite Index. The first thing that might jump out at you is, what in the world is going on here? This is now. That's 2009, the bottom of the financial crisis. It looks like we're in the biggest bull market ever. I'm not going to qualify that. But earnings look choppy and seem to be correlated a bit with it. But earnings overall have been growing along kind of a steady trend for almost 150 years. So what's all this movements? What determines all these movements? I did say that I want to qualify my statement that this is the biggest stock market boom ever, by saying percentage-wise it's not. And one way you can see that is plot with a log scale or a ratio scale. You see, this is a little technical, but that's 10 times 10 times 10. And this is even 10 times more. So it puts everything so that you can get a percentage change sense. So here we are. It's a pretty big boom we've had. But it's not the big, I say it's the fourth biggest. The biggest is 1929. That's called the Roaring Twenties. All right. By the way, it ended badly. That's 1932. It was all the way back down below 1921. So that's the biggest. And then, I don't know what second was that, but then over the 60s or so, really, up to the year 2000. And then here we are. So there must be something driving this. And what is it? I can tell you through other knowledge, it's not the usual culprits that you think of, like interest rates or GDP. These things are just mysterious movements that I think require maybe some storytelling. And that's what I'm doing in my book. So what I call narrative economics is study of stories people tell and understandings that people have of how the economy works, which informs their decision. Economists like to say that people are rational and take account of all information as it comes in. That means they think like economists, but a lot of people don't. And their actions make things happen. So I've been going through these periods, and it's not just in terms of the stock market, but in terms of GDP and other markets. And let me go back ahead a little bit more and talk about home prices. This is a plot. These are both plots from my book, Irrational Exuberance, which is now in its third edition. It came out in the blue line is home prices in the United States since 1890, in real terms, corrected for inflation. This is not New York City, by the way. This is the United States. And again, what's going on right now? haven't changed. This surprises me when I came out with this. People are surprised. They said, aren't we running out of land? Isn't it getting scarce? Well, my data don't show that home prices didn't go up in real terms for 100 years. But then they have these strange swings. So this is the bubble that preceded the millennium. So what's driving? I'll tell you what's not driving them. It's not building costs. Because this is a building cost, and what it costs to build a house. It doesn't look anything like home prices. Maybe it did back here in the good old days, before 1950. Building costs were declining and home prices were declining. The economists back then kept saying, home prices will continue to fall because we're getting better and better at building homes. Home prices should come down with the cost. They thought they had it all figured out, but home prices haven't behaved that way. I just want to say that I think that the cause of these big fluctuations is very human and very personal. It's some kinds of stories. And I was just going to give you some sense of stories for each of these. But it's a complicated. My book is not a final word on this topic. I think it's a very difficult topic to research. What were the stories and understandings people had? We're getting better at it, though, with digitized texts. And I have now, and other people, many people are starting to do this, is they do searches, semantic search, and other kinds of search for phrases and ideas. And you can search in newspapers, advertisements, magazines, sermons, diaries, all kinds of things that you can indicate what people were saying and talking about. And you have to not just search them numerically, you have to go back and read them to get a sense. The power of a story depends on how it's told. And you're not in a mindset to understand the story, why it had emotional impact. But I can talk, I was just going to finish by giving you a few stories. There was this big fall in the real home prices leading into 1920. Why did it fall? But it was probably because they weren't used to it. We had a new Federal Reserve that was printing money really fast. We had 100% inflation. The people didn't adjust for that. So real home prices fell. Maybe that's a little anomalous. But look at the next one here. This is 1942 to 1947. Huge upswing in home prices. Why do you think that happened? I'm sorry, I'd like to ask you to answer. I'll tell you. You got it. She said the end of the war. But it started before the end of the war. It started 1942 was the bottom of the market. And in 1943 it was starting to boom. Okay, I'll just put a little more embellishment on your answer. People thought the end of the war was coming soon. And these soldiers are coming back and they're gonna want to have families, and they haven't been building any houses. So let's speculate, let's buy the houses now. And so the whole thing took place during the war. Annoying many people. What you don't see in those narratives is any sense that home prices always go up or that housing is the best investment. It was topical. It was right now because of the war. So it's a totally different boom than we have now. And then I want to go to this boom, which is the biggest ever. What caused that? Well, it's a lot of things. But I mentioned stories about flippers. Now the story was that home prices have always gone up. The expectation was that home prices would go up, according to one of my surveys I did in 2004, 12% a year. Hey, the mortgage rate is only 6% a year. This sounds like a no-brainer. Buy as many houses as you could. That was the narrative. Totally different from the 1942 and 47 narrative. Now I don't have a really great explanation of the current, but I invite your suggestions. What is happening now? Well, it's not as big. I think it has something to do with Donald J. Trump, who is a sort of inspiration for a real estate. He's a real estate president. Something is happening in our culture now that is encouraging. But I'm not sure that it's so steady or stable. So I'm not going to give you a really enlightening answer. Let me go back to the stock market. So you can see what was happening here. We had a big drop in the stock market that bottomed out in 1921. Why? Why did that happen? Well, I think it was partly because of an American set sort of anger against companies who made a lot of profits during World War I. And that was called profiteering. It was a new word. And people, the emotional trauma of the war was transformed into this anger at business. So they put on a huge excess profits tax on corporate profits above 1913 levels. And they didn't take it off until, I think it was 22. So people were angry. And they were boycotting companies. They blamed the inflation on evil companies that were pushing prices up. And so I'm gonna postpone buying anything from these evil companies. But it kind of ended quickly, and that's another puzzle. I don't have everything completely understood. And then it brought us in, then they completely changed. The new narrative in the roaring 20s was about stock market millionaires who made huge sums of money. There was a time of acceptance of business schemes. Then what happened in 1929? There's this huge, the stock market fell 85% in real terms in a matter of less than 3 years. How can that possibly happen? How can it drop so much? But you can see what was also happening. Sales of Ford cars fell 85% from 1929 to 1932. Now that's huge, huge drop. Why is that? Well, I think it was, this is what I'm trying to research for my book. It has something to do with it's a number of narratives that happened to coincide at that time. But notably among them was a narrative that robots are taking over our jobs. Believe it or not, they call them robots. There was a 1920 play by Carol Chapek called Rossum's Universal Robot, which coined the term. And they used it loosely through many automated equipment that they had in the 1930s. So people thought they were about to lose their jobs and they would never get them back. They were replaced by a robot. They tended to believe this because it seemed plausible at this time when unemployment was so high, but it was actually the belief that was causing it. Another thing that happened in the Great Depression was that there was a movement toward frugality. That, you don't have to live like the keeping up with the Joneses. You don't have to be rich. America is built on humble people who are, there was some idea. You actually felt ashamed to spend money during the Great Depression. There was a tremendous sympathy for people who lost their jobs. There were narratives about someone had a family of four kids, he lost his job, he's not coming back, he's trying to sell his house, he's gonna go bankrupt because he can't pay off the mortgage. And those stories were sob stories. So one thing about the Depression that you probably didn't know, some commentators during the Great Depression said, I actually like it now because people are just nicer. They're not so show-off. This is a changing narrative. I think I'm almost out of time. Let me just go and talk about what I call the millennium. This is a huge boom in stock prices. And what was it driven by? It's related to this robot story, but it was the internet and networking that people thought would maybe reduce their. It's complicated. They were not holding back on their spending until after 2000, then we had a recession. But they believed that the internet was changing their lives, and it took on great proportions. What we have now, the last thing, I think it's again this same perennial narrative that comes back with new forms. The newest form is an artificial intelligence or machine learning. And it's again, we keep thinking each of these boom periods is a hypothesized new era that people think is now changes everything. Our new narrative is somehow mixed in with Donald Trump and others like him. I think that we're spending money freely now, despite our fears about losing jobs, because we have something that Elizabeth Warren has argued about in her book. We feel that we have to survive in the new unequal world. We have to live high to establish ourselves as part of the elite class. We have to promote our children heavily. Don't let them just run out and play. Have them study or do activities to get into an elite university. So this culture was not present in the Great Depression, not very strong. And it's now taken, so we are spending a lot, but we're also believing a lot in financial markets. That's a little bit good, but the conclusion that I want to leave with you is that I think that there will be changes in economic and financial research in the not so distant future that will enable us to get a better picture. It won't be as simple as I've described, because there's many different narratives competing at the same time. It's not easy to study these. Not many people are trying. Marketing people are trying for marketing purposes, but I think we have to try to study the changing narratives that envelop our lives with a purpose more broad about understanding how major economic events happen and how we might be vulnerable to them. So I'll stop, and if you have other interpretations of my narrative that I'd like to know about. So we have a mic.
If you can speak loudly with your question, and the professor will repeat it for the rest of the room. Take a couple questions.
All right. Thank
you. If you were wondering about why real estate values may be high today, if my memory serves me well, last time you were here, you were talking about your study about true and false information around the world, and that perhaps there's more false information today than there's ever been. Some would argue that we're living in a world of mistrust in institutions and governments and private enterprise. Is there something there as to why people believe hard assets like home may sustain value more? And finally, you talked about emerging technologies.
Okay, good question. I hope they'll repeat it.
But do you think a transparency such as blockchain could play a role in finding money?
Oh, okay. Now you're simulating me to talk about blockchain. I think it's kind of, I don't have the ability in a short talk or even in a book to explain accurately all of these movements. But home price increases are partly due to those low interest rates. But overall, interest rates haven't explained home price movements that much. I think it's a multiple narrative story. Now you bring up blockchain. That's a technology used by Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. I talk about this in my book. I'm interested in it from a different standpoint. I try to figure out the technology. There's a good book by Narayanan on understanding blockchain, but I still find it a very obscure science. There's some smart people who designed Bitcoin. Whether they're good people and doing something for humanity is another question. They're smart. But I think that the phenomenal success of, temporary success of Bitcoin, was, if you know what I'm talking about, it's an electronic form of money that was invented by Mr. Satoshi Nakamoto, supposedly. It's supposed to be the wave of the future. The value of the Bitcoin reached over $300 billion out of nothing in a matter of a few years. Why did it sweep the world like this? That's a different question than how does it work. And I think that to me, the answer is there's some mutation or improvement in an old narrative that brought Bitcoin to be an exciting, contagious story that could go viral. I compare it in my book with the bimetallism fad that developed in the 1870s, 80s, 90s, but it peaked in 1896. Remember this one? Does it ring a bell? Actually, though, you do know about it indirectly. I got it. You said no.
Use of silver.
Yeah, it is. But what, do you remember story called The Wizard of Oz? Well, that was written in 1896, exactly the peak year. That's a book by L. Frank Baum. And apparently, there's some controversy about this. The Yellow Brick Road is gold standard. And Dorothy wore silver slippers. And the Wizard of Oz was President McKinley. And the lion was William Jennings Bryan. You're doubtful. It is. It does look like that story was part of the book that L. Frank Baum wrote was panned by critics. Critics. It's a children's book, really, but they didn't like it. But it was a huge bestseller. I think it had something to do with the spirit of that time. So the bimetallism was another proposal to change the money stock, and it was described in the most emotional terms. I can get into that. Like, you should read the Coins Financial School, 1894. It's a wonderful book. It's all wrong in economic theory. It has lots of pictures on economic book. But let me just say, Bitcoin, I think, benefits from a narrative that started in the 1840s by philosopher Proudhon, who said that he was the founder of anarchism, and he just hated government. He thinks government ruins our lives by regulating us and kind of imprisoning us with regulations. That narrative of anarchist narrative got tainted by the impression that many of its followers gave that anarchism will bring chaos. And so the beauty of Bitcoin was that it was described as allowing a sort of anarchism that works. That Bitcoin is not attackable by the government, according to the narrative. And there are lots of smart people, like described by Ayn Rand in their novels, that are smart and pinned down by repressive governments. And this is a way out. It's a wonderful future for the whole world. And we don't even need governments anymore. And they have, some of these people are openly anarchists. They even use that word. I don't think that Bitcoin is famous for the reasons that people think about it. Bitcoin has some impressive technology, but the other engineers who designed this technology, you never heard of them. Nobody cares about. They don't have a good story. They love the story of Satoshi Nakamoto, partly because nobody can find him. it's another perennial story called The Mystery. Why would somebody invent Bitcoin and then walk away and not be nowhere? And so how can doesn't somebody know him? Nobody knows. The original Bitcoin founders got an email from Satoshi Nakamoto. And they did what he said, they created it. This is an amazing story. And then he stopped it, Satoshi stopped answering his emails. He's just gone. Frank Wright was an ambassador who claimed he was Satoshi Nakamoto. That's been discredited. So it's just such a wonderful story. That's why we have Bitcoin and blockchain. Yes.
Professor Shiller, I'd like to ask my Passover question, which is, why is this recovery different from all other recoveries? seen a real estate market this late into recovery where you don't have a supply problem. And I'm wondering whether that might be at least partially the cause for the run-up in housing prices over the last 10 years.
So he's asking about housing prices and the supply issue. So there is a puzzle. How a home price could have gone up? It's gone up a lot. It's almost up to the peak that it did before the financial crisis. Wouldn't you think that if home prices are going up, builders would be rushing to build more houses? That's what happened. You might say that's what happened here. There was a lot of construction begging this boom. So why is it? Now, I'm not able to give a final answer on that. One thing, though, is that a lot of people who were in the construction industry left it for the financial crisis. And so there is now suddenly a shortage of skilled labor. This seems right to me because my son and daughter-in-law just hired a nurse to take care of their new baby. And he's a former construction worker. The other thing is that there is a supply, natural supply constraint that people want their houses in the right place. And we have zoning laws that are restricting that. There's natural limits to Manhattan. Manhattan, for example, had a housing boom in the 1880s. I remember reading newspaper narratives about that. One of them said, do you know that practically nothing is built in New York anymore that's less than 5 stories high? Because we're just running out of land in Manhattan. So that was a narrative that must have been the talk of the country. Everyone knew that Manhattan was going through the roof. But it wasn't applicable to other parts of the country, so it didn't sweep the country. Now we think it happens everywhere. I'm just picking the people I see up front.
If narratives are driving markets, do you have any thoughts regarding how narratives arise and coalesce?
He's asking me, how do narratives arise and coalesce? In my book, and in my presidential address, which you can find now on the web, I rely on, there's many other traditions related to epidemics, many other thought processes outside of economics. I was particularly influenced by medical school, mathematical epidemiology, which they teach in medical schools. Some economists read that, but it hasn't taken over widely. So this is not a new literature. In 1927, Kermack and McKendrick wrote a medical journal article about a mathematical model of epidemics that described how things go viral. And they had a two-parameter model. They had a contagion rate and a recovery rate. Now, typically, the contagion rate is below the recovery rate is higher than the contagion rate. And if that happens, no epidemic is possible. People get over it faster than they spread it. But if some little mutation or change in the environment raises the contagion rate above the recovery rate, then it'll just explode. There's a lot of evidence that disease epidemics really work that way. So I think this is an insight that you get from medical schools that you don't find in much economic discussion. That suddenly everyone's talking about Bitcoin. Why is that? It's because somebody else was talking about it. And so, I mean, we all hear about it. And eventually you decide, I better learn something about this because everyone's talking about it. It's the same thing with, say, movies. People who manufacture motion picture producers will tell you that it's a huge gamble. To predict the success of a movie requires involves subtle differences in contagion rate. Do people talk about this movie? Word of mouth is a heavy promoter of things like that. And you just don't know whether the rate of talk will be high enough. So epidemics keep coming up, both of physical diseases that come up to the medical school, but also in the economics. So I like to pursue that in parallel.
Mark, so you may- sir, in the corner, yes.
Well, that's a long and lengthy story, right? Attitudes toward, he's asking about, he must have heard that, attitudes toward income taxes that they developed over time. Income tax came in 1913 as a way of avoiding particular inequities in taxes, which were more concentrated on tariffs and property at that time. So it's supposed to be an improvement, but yeah, it led to a sense of injustice. There's also a wealth tax, which is separate from an income tax. And people's ideas of fairness depend on, not sure exactly how. So Elizabeth Warren wants a wealth tax. I think that sounds like, to most people, like theft, whereas an income tax is different. Because with a wealth tax, you're taxing income of the past, and now you're springing it on people afterwards. So there's issues of fairness, how these things are framed. You know, our attitudes toward income tax have changed a lot. During World War II, the income tax rate reached 94% on the highest tax bracket. There's a wonderful book by Shevins the Savage, a couple of political scientists, who analyze how tax rates actually change, what drives tax rates. And they make the interesting conclusion is that when inequality gets worse, do you think tax rates on the rich would go up? Well, they studied 20 countries over a century, and they said a flat no, that's not history. If inequality gets worse, they will not raise the taxes on the rich. So how did we ever get taxes on the rich? We got it through wars. It always happens during wartime. Because some young men are giving their lives. How can you complain about having to give 94%? But then you live, right? We're not putting you out of debt. So some rich person is profiting from the war. Hey, 94% sounds right to most people in that circumstance.
Well, please join me in thanking Professor Shiller.